So while reporting, I always start the reporting whenever I do reporting with T2 weighted images. This is like a basic approach to see the pathology at present. So today, we will discuss about what basically are the differences in a T2 and a T1 weighted images. So how you distinguish from a image, like you will always not get a telecompatible laptop like this, or you will be reporting directly from the film. How to distinguish between a T1 and T2 weighted image from a film directly? That's what I'm going to tell you now. So what basically you have to look is two things. One, you have to look the color of the CSF. So this is white in T2 and it will be dark in T1. Okay, so now the question comes, is there any other particular sequence which the same thing is darker? So yes, there is. So the same thing goes for flare images as well. So why it happens? Because flare is essentially a T2 image with fluid attenuation inversion. That means it suppresses whatever fluid is there, it suppresses it. So this is T2, this is T1, this is flare. So how to differentiate these three images from each other? From T1 with T2, you have to look at the CSF, then T1 it will be darker, in T2 it will be brighter. What about T1 and flare? So the same thing, like any other things, like you can see for the other structures of the brain. See, the next thing to compare is the gray and white matter. So how it looks. So remember, the gray as well as white matter in MRI brain is considered based upon its imaging appearance on T1 weighted images. So I'll tell you how. So in MRI, the gray images, the gray matter images will appear like this. So the gray matter will be darker. See, this is the gray matter of T1. See the gray matter appearance on T2, it will be brighter compared to the white matter. So you can see here the gray matter is darker, the white matter is brighter in T1 weighted images. So this is T1 weighted images. Or in the meanwhile, here the gray matter is brighter and the white matter is darker on T2 weighted images. Same thing in flare. When you want to distinguish between flare and T1, you can see the same thing. In flare, the gray matter will be brighter and the white matter will be darker. So essentially, in flare, apart from the CSF signal changes, the remaining all things will follow T2. So that is the basic difference you have to see for and T2, T1 and flare images. This is how you distinguish between T2, T1 and flare images. So another set of images are there actually, which I didn't discuss in purpose. It is called fat suppressed sequences. So what are fat suppressed sequences? Which are basically anything which is of the same nature of the image which are done without fat suppressing. For example, this is a T1 non-fat suppressed image. This is a T1 fat suppressed image. What is the difference? So as you can see, this white area representing outside is actually the scalp and it is not the calv area. Very often I have found my radiology residents misinterpreting this as calv area. It is not calv area, it is the scalp. So when you see scalp tissue on T1 as well as T2, since it contains a lot of fat, it will appear bright in both. But once you apply fat suppression sequences, you can generally see wherever the suppression is adequate, it will go for a darker imaging like this. Can you see this? Yeah, this is the darker appearance of the scalp fat. And apparently it will look much thinner than compared to that of the original T1 and T2 weighted images. That is because of some physics part which we'll discuss later on. So, but basically imaging wise, how you distinguish between a normal SE image and a fat suppressed image? You see for the T1, see for the T1 FS, see for the scalp, bright on normal SE images, that is T1 and T2 SE images, and darker in FS images. So similar appearance will also be seen in stir images, that is actually suppression of fat. Okay, so remember that. So basically the remaining all things will be the same on T1 and T1 FS, except for the part where the fat gets suppressed out. So on another thing which you would have noticed from both of these images is the calvarial appearance. So you see the calvarial appearance. The calvaria basically appears dark in on T2, T1, and FS, the darkness is more predominant. So this thing is actually quite interesting. There are some pathologies where you can see there is a vertebrate brightening happening in the calvaria. It's always seen, associated changes will always be seen in T2 flare as well as FS images. So that is a discussion for another part, which we will not do now. So this is the thing. So see, the thickness is almost the same. Only thing is the suppression is more, because you, as you know, all bone has marrow and all marrow has fat. So the marrow fat has been suppressed. That is what it is. So the reason gray and white matter is called so in MRI is basically it's based upon T1 weighted imaging. The gray matter is the signal appearance of gray matter in T1 weighted imaging, and white matter is the signal appearance in white matter imaging. So why there is a difference of appearance of gray and white here? The reason is simple. It's because of myelination. So gray matter consists of neuron cells, white matter consists of axons. So basically axons are myelinated, hence the change, signal change. So in T2 there is relative change in the signal characteristics. It's because of the same thing. Here the myelinated axons are appearing darker compared to that of the non-myelinated white matter, gray matter. So that is the basic interpretation of T1, T2, FS, and as well as flare. So there are newer machines, newer technologies involving where you can actually calculate the vector of diffusion. You can then put it into values and you can do imagings like diffusion tensor imaging and all. Those are recent advances kind of things, which we'll discuss later if anyone asks for it, or we'll do it in a later video. So this is that. So now coming to the last of the basic imaging sequences, that is gradient echo imaging. So this is a basic gradient echo imaging. In gradient echo imaging, what we look for are mainly two things. The same things you can also look in SWA imaging with more accuracy, but in our machine we have only gradient echo imaging. And if I get hand on some SWA images, I'll put it in a later video, follow-up video if possible. So what we are seeing here is whether or not there is a chance for a bleeding foci in here. So basically what we are looking is any bleed or any hemorrhage related products or any paramagnetic substances on the brain parenchyma, paramagnetic or ferromagnetic substance in the brain parenchyma will have a darker signal on gradient echo imaging. Based on that principle, if you are supposed to be seeing there a dark ring here, whether if it is dark here and it is becoming more darker here, so it is not becoming more darker here, apparently it is okay looking normal, we will say that we will report it as there is significant signal drop on GRE images in that particular images, comma, correlates with blooming artifact. What it indicates is there is a possibility that can be an hemorrhage. Okay, so that's how you use basic all reporting modalities in a plain MRI evaluation. So in addition to this, if you do want to do a contrast image, what you have to acquire is a pre and post contrast study of in T1 weighted images. Basically that is the international protocol followed. Now we are also acquiring flare images also in post contrast, because it helps a lot in distinguishing between periventricular enhancement as well as gyral enhancement, which is sometimes missed in routine T1 weighted imaging. So gyral enhancement is best seen on flare images. So for that reason, we are usually reporting it like that. So as you can see here, so this is a T1 plain FS image. This is a T1 post contrast FS image. This is a flare post contrast FS image. So what we have here is in T1 plain image, you can see the lesion is very dark, which is actually similar to the T1 image which we have seen in the plane study, that is the T1 flare image which we have acquired. So this is the T1 image which we had acquired. See, you can see the similarity in both. Slight signal increase is expected in all FS images we want. So only significant post contrast enhancement is commented upon. So here you can see how intensely the lesion is enhancing and somewhat uniformly. So based on the enhancement characteristics and other appearances of the lesion, we can conclude whether it is an intraaxial, extraaxial, whether it is similarly enhancing, differently enhancing, intensely enhancing, heterogeneously enhancing, homogeneously enhancing, based upon the enhancement pattern. If I have to report this case, I will be reporting it as intensely, somewhat homogeneously enhancing lesion in the extraaxial plane probably, and depending upon the mass effects, you have to report about the mass effects. So the basic things are the mass effects. So all these things should come in your report. So this outlines the basics of MRI brain reporting. And one additional sequences which we usually take are something like 3D post-contrast imaging. This is especially useful in determining smaller lesions, mass effects, gyral enhancement, similar things in brain. Especially you have temporal pathologies which are having smaller enhancing focuses. You will get it is easily picked in these images. And one interesting thing, if you see here, you can see the close attachment of the lesion towards the fox here, which is not very evident in all other images. And one advantage of this particular image is you can always go for a 3D recon of the image. You can do a 3D of this image, which is not possible with any other images. So this is the basic outline of MRI brain reporting. So this thing is how you do the things in my department. And there might be one or two additional sequences which include use of perfusion studies, use of spectroscopy. Some special sequences are implied in studying of your basal cisterns, your cisternal magna and all, to see the nerves. So those things we can discuss later on. This essentially forms the basic of reporting. Any other requests you can put it in the comments page, and I'll sure to help that part. Thank you. So this is the sagittal reconstruction of the same FSPGR sequences. So this is the axial recon. So basically you have three plane comparison of the same lesion in this sequence. Okay, thank you. Thank you so much. Hopefully you would like my video, and I hope that you subscribe to this video so that I can fund more and more videos with better equipment. So this is basically my first video which I am recording using a GoPro Hero 8. So if you want to know about the specs, and my laptop is this is basically a laptop which I am reporting for my teleradiology solutions. This is a Dell G3 15 inch laptop which I purchased last year, and I'm using our Windows Movie Maker to make and combine and edit different videos. So these are the specs. Thank you.